Well, hello everybody, and welcome to Pollution Probe's Healthy Communities Campaign webinar on climate change and indoor air quality. Thanks for joining us today. My name is Stephanie Thorson, and I'm the director of Pollution Probe's Human Health Program. This webinar is about the link between your health and the built environment and climate change. Today we touch on these three topics, and we include time for your questions and answers from health experts. So to ask a question, just click on the bubble icon at the top of your screen, and I'll then read the questions to our speakers. Here are your speakers today, as you know from the promotions. Pollution Probe is grateful to have experts from Health Canada featured in our webinar today. We're going to conduct a quick poll on each topic before each speaker begins. So be sure to vote when the question pops up on your screen. So before we begin, a very quick overview of who we are. Pollution Probe was formed in 1969 and is one of Canada's oldest environmental charities. A book published in 2015 called The First Green Wave tells the story of Pollution Probe's early years and our role in shaping Canada's environmental movement and environment policy. From our early focus on pollution and clean air and water, we've become a trusted voice on Canada's most pressing environmental needs. And currently we have three areas of focus: human health, transportation, and energy policy and energy literacy. Our human health program aims to improve the health of communities across Canada by reducing health risks from exposures to harmful elements of the natural and built environments. Our key areas of focus are climate change and toxics, and our audiences are workplaces and educational institutions. The Healthy Communities Campaign, this webinar is part of our Healthy Communities Campaign and is funded by Great West Life. This is a free, easy to join initiative for workplaces, providing valuable information about what you can do to reduce the health effects associated with climate change. Currently, we're focused on the interactions between health and changes in the built environment due to climate change, and all of our past topics, including health impacts due to changes in the natural environment, are available on our website. And if you're not a regular campaign participant, you can sign up today on our website. So broadly speaking, the link between climate change and indoor air quality comes from society's efforts to curb greenhouse gas emissions to address climate change. And as we seal our homes and businesses for better energy efficiency, we need to make sure we ventilate properly to address indoor air pollution, radon, and mold. So today I talk about these sources of air pollution: gas ranges and space heaters, open wood fireplaces, home improvement activities, and smoking. And all I say about smoking is to avoid smoking indoors or open a window while smoking to avoid the health impacts of secondhand smoke. So I'm just going to do our poll at this point. All right, interesting. Well, most people are aware. All right, for most homes with gas stoves, this is actually the biggest source of air pollution. A team of Lawrence Berkeley National Laboratory indoor air researchers have found hazardous levels of nitrogen dioxide and carbon monoxide in a surprisingly large portion of California home kitchens. And their studies have shown that the most common device for mitigating this indoor air pollution, range hoods, vary widely in performance. They found a significant portion of residences exceed outdoor air quality standards for several pollutants on a weekly basis because they're cooking with gas burners. They note that if these conditions were outdoors, the EPA would be cracking down, but since it's in people's homes, there's no regulation requiring anyone to fix it. So reducing people's exposure to pollutants from gas stoves should be a public health priority, according to the lab. And a previous Berkeley Lab study found that the aggregate health consequences of poor indoor air quality, of which cooking is the major but not the only source, are as significant as those from all traffic accidents or infectious diseases in the United States. So what can we do about this? Range hoods, let's talk for a minute about range hoods. It's very important that you turn on the range hood every time you cook and set the fan to the highest setting that the noise is tolerable. And make sure it vents to the outdoors. Sometimes air is just recirculated in the kitchen, and that won't help your indoor air quality. If your range hood does not extend over the front burners of the stove, cooking on the back burners could make the hood up to twice as effective at removing pollutants. And if you're buying a new hood, it should cover the front burners and have a setting that moves at least 200 cubic feet of air per minute. I should note that when I was shopping for a range hood myself, there's quite a bit of variation in the power, and some of the more stylish range hoods don't have a lot of power, so that's something to watch for if you're shopping for a new range hood. And if having a range hood isn't possible, opening a window while cooking does help. All right, on to wood-burning fireplaces. So smoke is made up of a complex mixture of gases and fine microscopic particles produced when wood and other organic material burns. And the biggest health threat from wood smoke comes from the fine particles, also called particulate matter. They're small enough to enter the lungs, where they can cause bronchitis, pneumonia, asthma, or other serious respiratory diseases. And fine particles can also aggravate chronic heart and lung diseases and are linked to premature deaths in people with these chronic conditions. There is no level of ventilation that will eliminate the harmful effects of smoke, but you can ensure sufficient fresh air intake into the home through opening a window slightly to enable the wood smoke and particulates to leave the home through the chimney. But sealed low-emission stoves are much better. You can install an advanced combustion wood stove or fireplace insert to reduce toxic emissions. And look for appliances that have a sticker from the US EPA. The sticker would certify that the appliance emits up to 95% fewer particulates and is up to 20% more fuel efficient than regular models. So the Canadian government refers Canadians to the US EPA's BurnWise program. And it goes into details on the following topics. Maintain your stove, clean your chimney, use your dampers, and burn wisely. So that means avoid burning wood on days when air pollution levels are high. And also the type of wood you burn and the way you store it also matters. And you can check their website for more details, or I can go into more details during the questions if you're interested. Increasing your home energy efficiency often means better insulation and sealing air leaks. And as we make these improvements, there's some impacts on air quality. Painting, paint stripping, welding, sanding, or using pesticides and toxic cleaners can cause indoor air pollution. So best to conduct these tasks outside where possible, or open a window during these activities. And consider choosing low emission paints and varnishes. Now, asbestos removal certainly involves potential health impacts as fine particles can damage lungs. And if your home improvements involve asbestos removal, you need to call in the professionals who will take the appropriate precautions in removal and they'll dispose of the material properly. And when conducting home renovations, dust is inevitable, but containing the dust with simple, low-cost barriers will help protect your health and decrease your cleaning needs. Ventilating the enclosed space is also important. And finally, just a word about heat recovery ventilators. Increasing your home energy efficiency means sealing your home more tightly, and advanced designs of some new homes or renovated homes may feature mechanical systems that bring outdoor air into the home through heat recovery ventilators. These units maximize the energy efficiency of your home or business by bringing fresh air, outdoor air, into the building and transferring the heat from the outgoing air. So this is a more climate-friendly way to reduce indoor air pollution than opening a window near the source of pollution, like in the kitchen or near a fireplace or while conducting your home improvements. So you can learn more about these topics by following the links on our webpage. Just go to pollutionprobe.org/healthycommunities. And here's my contact information as well. So at this point, we have time for a couple of questions. Okay, so here's a question. Could you comment on particulate pollution from road traffic entering the home? Specifically, how fast does particulate pollution drop off with distance from a major highway? I know that Health Canada has studied particulate pollution, has looked at this particular issue, and I know that concerns have been raised in relation to schools and diesel buses idling outside of windows. I think the particulate pollution does drop off quite quickly. I do not know the exact distance, and but I can find that information for you and connect with you after the webinar. I hope that's helpful. Okay. It appears that the highest risk is 50 to 100 meters from a busy road. And then, so that risk is 4% higher. Those living within 50 meters of a busy road have a 7% higher risk in developing dementia. The risk is 4% higher at 50 to 100 meters and 2% higher at 100 to 200 meters. And then they didn't see a risk at beyond 200 meters. That's specific to one particular disease. And again, if you're interested, I can get information on more respiratory related diseases. Okay, thanks for the questions. Please feel free, as the other speakers are chatting, to enter your questions, and we can take more some at the end as well. So at this time, I'm going to turn it over to Kelly Bush from Health Canada. Over to you, Kelly.
Thank you very much, Stephanie, and hello, everyone. So my name is Kelly, and I am the head of radon education and awareness for our National Radon Program at Health Canada's Radiation Protection Bureau, and I'm happy to be here today to talk to you about radon. So first of all, let's start with the basics. What is radon? In my perfect world, because I'm leading the National Radon Program for the outreach component of it, I hope you already know this, but I am aware that unfortunately not enough Canadians yet know about what radon is and what the health impacts are. So radon is a radioactive gas that comes from the ground. It comes from uranium in the ground, which is everywhere in the Earth's crust. As the uranium breaks down, it forms a radioactive gas called radon that could come out of the ground. When it comes out of the ground and mixes with outdoor air, it isn't considered a health risk. It is diluted, but it can find its way into a home or a building and accumulate to high levels and become a very serious health risk. Radon actually is almost 50% of our lifetime radiation exposure. So everyone is exposed to radon. All homes and buildings have some level of radon. So over your lifetime, radon is going to be one of the biggest contributors from a radiation exposure perspective for all of you. It's important to know, as we're talking about the risk from radon, it's indoor exposure. And I often get questions about, well, where is it a problem in Canada? And so it needs to be very clear that all homes and buildings have some level of radon, unless, of course, you're on stilts, in a tree house, or in a boathouse. So the question isn't, if you have radon in your home or in your workplace or in your children's school or in the daycare, it's how much. And the only way to know is to test. And most importantly, if a high level of radon is found, it can be fixed. And I really want to emphasize this because we've had our National Radon Program in place for almost 10 years now. And this is still something that people believe is very complicated, expensive, and difficult to fix. And for that reason, often people don't want to think about radon and having to do something about it because they think it'll be just too much, too overwhelming. And that's absolutely not the case. Techniques to lower radon levels are effective and can save lives. Radon levels can be reduced by more than 80% in less than a day. A system takes less than a day to install for the same cost as other common home repairs. Health Canada revised our guidelines in 2007. And this guideline, the guideline was revised as a result of more current research that had been completed for residential radon levels. So our original guideline was based on the research that was available at the time, which had to do with exposure in uranium mines. But in the early 2000s, more research, more pooled research internationally became available that indicated that there was a risk at lower levels in residential environments. And so we lowered our guideline from 800 to 200, which is a significant decrease. And to ensure that Canadians were properly informed about what that change to the guideline meant and what they could do, what the guidance was to reduce their risk from radon exposure, the National Radon Program was developed. So how does radon find its way into a home? I've told you already, it's in all homes and buildings. And this you can see on the screen is a depiction of basically all the different ways that radon gas can find its way into the home. Cracks in the foundation floors and walls. There's always gaps around pipes. Whenever a home or a building is built, there is actually a gap called the floor wall joint, which is one of the biggest ways radon can get in because there is basically a big opening there where the gas can seep in, sump holes, et cetera. So all of these are areas that radon can get in. Again, I often hear from people, oh, well, my foundation floor is perfect. I have no cracks. It doesn't matter. Concrete is porous. Radon gas does not actually need a gas to find its way in. The other thing that's really important to understand is it's not only how many openings, but the pressure differential between your home, the ground under your home and the inside the home. And what can happen is when that pressure difference exists, your house starts acting a bit like a vacuum and draws soil gas along with radon into the home. And so that plays a part in how much radon actually enters a home. Again, I often get questions about, can you tell me my neighbor has high levels of radon, or I heard about someone in our community that has high levels of radon. Does that mean I'm going to? And of all the studies that we've done, we've tried to correlate the data that we collect to see if there are certain types of homes, certain age of homes, et cetera, because it would make our job a lot easier if we could tell people specifically who's at risk. But all of the findings, not just in Canada, but internationally where this type of research has been done, is consistent. There is no correlation. We know in the Ottawa area, where I am from, that there's a community where there's high levels of radon. But you can go down that street and you can have one house with high levels of radon and the two neighbors on either side with low levels. So it really, the only way to know is to test. And so what are the health risks? And radon is the number one cause of lung cancer in non-smokers. It's the second leading cause after smoking. Absolutely, the most important thing to do to reduce your risk of lung cancer is to quit smoking. But it's important to know about radon as well. We estimate that approximately 16%, over 3,000 lung cancer deaths a year are radon induced. Lung cancer is the only known health effect associated to long-term radon exposure. So the risk from radon is a combination of three things essentially: how long you're exposed to radon, the levels that you're exposed to, and your smoking habits. Because previous smokers also exposed to high levels of radon have a significantly increased risk of developing lung cancer, as you can see in the image that's depicted on the slide. So despite all of this information that I've shared with you so far, that radon is in all homes and buildings, that it represents almost 50% of your radiation exposure over your lifetime, that it's the second leading cause of lung cancer after smoking, people's response to radon, for a number of different reasons, is often apathetic. They just don't, they don't think it's going to be an issue for them. They don't think they need to, it's something they need to worry about. And we realized this early on in our program. And one of the things we wanted to do as we raised awareness about this was to find ways or risks that people could compare the risk of radon to figure out how they should respond to this issue. And so this is a chart that if you've ever been in any of my presentations before, I talk about, because I think it's really the most impactful message or with regards to trying to decide how what you should do or what you want to do or how you want to weigh the risk of radon. So if you look at the first two lines, the orange and the green line, the orange being the lifetime radon exposure risk for a non-smoker, so risk of death, versus all accidental deaths combined, which is the second line, the green line. And you can see as the radon level increases, at 400, it's almost equivalent, and at 800, the risk from radon exposure for a non-smoker is higher than all accidental deaths combined. So the message is really simple. If you put a seatbelt on when you get in your car, if you put a life jacket on yourself or your kids when you get in a boat, if you change the batteries in your smoke detector, why would you not test your home and reduce the levels if they're high? So how can you test? It's super easy to test for radon. You have essentially two options. You can either hire a certified radon measurement professional, or you can purchase a do-it-yourself test kit. In either case, what Health Canada recommends is that homes should be tested for 3 months using a long-term device. The reason for that is radon levels can vary quite significantly over time. And I think I have a slide in a minute, and I'll talk to you a little bit about the importance of that. If you want to test, it's very easy to find either a certified professional or a test kit. You can simply go to takeactiononradon.ca/test. And there are lists of do-it-yourself test kits and certified professionals by province. Couldn't be easier. So why long-term testing? And this is important. First of all, our guideline level, which I spoke to you about earlier, the 200 becquerels per cubic meter, is based on an annual average exposure. So the only way you're going to know what your annual average exposure is to do a long-term test, because radon levels vary quite significantly over time. And as you can see by the picture on this slide here, if you do, there are short-term tests available on the market. And these days, everyone wants to get their answer immediately. And so there tends to be this desire or tendency to want to do the short-term test. But here's why you don't want to. If you take a look at that slide, you're with a short-term test, your risk of a false positive or a false negative is much higher. And if you're seriously concerned and you want to address this health issue, then you need to do a long-term test to make a decision as to whether or not you need to lower or the radon levels, mitigate your home to lower the radon levels in your home. So highly recommend a 3-month test. It's worth the rate, the wait. And the other thing is that we don't get lung cancer overnight. It's a long-term risk. So take the time to do the 3-month test. So here's the really important message that yes, radon levels in a home can be easily reduced. The standard method for radon reduction is active subslab depressurization. I often just refer to it as a radon reduction system. And while it's a mouthful, what it simply is a pipe, a PVC pipe that's put through your foundation floor and piped outside. And you can see it's either piped out at ground level as in the picture, the image on your left, or at roof line on the image on your right. And there's a fan attached to the pipe. And what that does is draws the soil gas from under the home, including the radon, and pushes it back outside where it gets diluted. And this type of system will reduce the radon level by well over 80%. What we recommend is that you hire a certified radon mitigation professional, and the certification program that we recognize is the Canadian National Radon Proficiency Program, and you can see their logo in the bottom left-hand corner of the slide, and you can find a list of all of the certified mitigation professionals across the country at c-nrpp.ca. And again, you can search by your postal code or you can search by province to find a certified mitigator in your area. So very easy. Typically, the cost of a radon mitigation system is somewhere in the range of $2,000 to $3,000. And I was talking with my colleague the other day, because we often compare it to, it's equivalent to other common home repairs or home costs. And we used to give, for example, a furnace or an air conditioner. Well, I changed my furnace in the last year or so, and it's significantly more expensive than $3,000. But these days, $2,000 to $3,000 is almost what you spend on a new washer and dryer, washer and dryer, actually. So, but this is a cost that you're spending to reduce your risk of lung cancer. So I can't emphasize enough that these techniques, this radon reduction system is very effective to reduce the radon level in your home. The image too on this slide is our guidance with regards to time frame to reduce. So I mentioned earlier that people's response to radon is often apathetic. I'm not worried about it. It's not going to happen to me, until they test and they find out they have high levels. And then we get a very different response from some people, and they're very concerned and they ask if they need to leave their home. And the answer is absolutely not. So this is where this guidance becomes very important, very relevant. And what we recommend is, if your levels are between 200 and 600 becquerels per cubic meter, that you take action to reduce the levels within 2 years, and if they're above 600, within a year. And really, the message simply is, reduce the radon level in your home as soon as you can. It will reduce your risk of lung cancer. So that covers off the part of my presentation that is about radon. And again, I'm going to repeat it, because I'm a big believer in repetition to make sure that people hear the message and pass it on. Radon is a radioactive gas. It comes from the ground. It's in all homes and buildings. It's easy to test. You want to do a long-term test for a minimum of 3 months, and it's easy to fix. And there are certified professionals across the country to help you with that. And it's the second leading cause of lung cancer after smoking. So it's an issue that's worth spending a little bit of time to do something about. So I wanted to spend just a little bit of time talking to you about what Health Canada is doing about radon, just to demonstrate the importance that we place on this issue. And so Health Canada has a national radon program in place that began in 2008, and we've done lots of work since the program began. And I just wanted to highlight a couple of things that we've done. First of all, it was important for us to walk the talk. We were going out to Canadians and telling them that all Canadians should test their home for radon, and if the levels are above our Canadian guideline, that they should take action to reduce it. So we did the same. We established a federal building testing program to ensure federal employees were not being exposed to high levels of radon. And at this point, we've tested over 20,000 buildings across the country. The other thing we needed to do is get a better understanding of radon levels across the country. So we've done some cross-Canada residential testing projects. We've tested a little over 18,000 homes, I think, at this point. And our findings were, on average, in Canada, 7% of homes test high, but that varies quite significantly across the country. The highest provinces were New Brunswick and Manitoba and Nova Scotia, and Yukon weren't far behind either. Interestingly, BC and Ontario were among the lower provinces, but I say that. And then in BC, while they were just under 4% of homes that were high, in interior and northern BC, between 20 and 40% of homes are testing high. And while in Ontario, I think the percentage was in and around 5%, over 30% of the health regions had more than 10% of homes that were testing high. And really what that means is, first of all, there were no areas. Nunavut was the only area where we didn't find any high levels of radon. And there's a number of reasons for that. Many homes are built on stilts or with airflow underneath the home, and there's also permafrost that contributes to how much radon can get into the home. But every other health region, we found high levels of radon. And we can't tell you, even if we know your neighbor has high levels, we can't tell you whether or not your house will. The only way to know is to test. One of the other things we wanted to do was make sure that as homes were being built, they were built in a way that would reduce the amount of radon that could get in and make it easier to install a radon reduction system if it was necessary. So we worked with the National Building Codes and had changes made in 2010 that include codes that will seal and reduce the amount of radon that can get in. It's not guaranteeing that there won't be radon, but just reduce the amount that can get in. And there's now a rough-in for that active subslab depressurization system that I described earlier. The other thing we did is we were going out and telling Canadians they need to do something about radon. And so we needed to make sure they had access to quality services and products. So we worked with stakeholders across the country and across the world, actually in the US as well, to ensure that there was a Canadian National Radon Proficiency Program, a certification program developed. So you have access to quality services and products. And we've done significant research in the area of radon testing and mitigation techniques. And we looked at building materials and granites and other potential contributors to really get an idea of radon sources and ways to reduce radon risk. And then we've developed an extensive radon education and awareness program across the country, which I'm responsible for. And just on that radon education and awareness program, there's a number of things that we do first. And foremost, November is Radon Action Month, so you may have seen some stuff in the media or heard some people talking about radon over the last month. And really, while November is Radon Action Month, the fall-winter timeframe is radon action season. And so there's a lot of activities that go on throughout the fall and winter timeframe because this is the time of year that we recommend is the best to test. The fall-winter is the longest part of our seasons and the most representative of our indoor air environment, so it's the best time to test. We distribute and promote our own Health Canada radon outreach materials across the country. We work with Canada Post's Smart Moves program, which is the change of address program that many of us have probably used. When you move, you put in for a change of address and you get a package of information. Sorry, there's some messages popping up on the side, so I just got distracted for a second. But anyways, yeah, so you get information when you move into a new home, and there's some information on radon encouraging you to test. We also target information to who we think are really important audiences, like health professionals. So we have an accredited continuing medical education course for doctors. We distribute pamphlets and information for to doctors' offices across the country. We engage with the building industry and the Canadian Real Estate Association and at-risk regions and communities. Based on the research that we've done, we know there are some communities that have much higher levels, and so we work to engage them with provinces and territories to see changes made to policies and regulations so that long-term there is less radon in houses and buildings. And so that brings me pretty much to the end of my presentation. You can see on the slide here, we have lots of outreach material. All of this material is available on our website. And actually, I should have updated this. We've recently changed over to canada.ca/radon, but this URL is also still very valid. And all of our materials, print materials, are available for free for it. So if you're interested, if you want to distribute them or share them with others, feel free to contact us and we're happy to send you some. So thank you very much. And here's my contact information. And I hope that you have found this information useful. And I hope that I've convinced you to go and test, if you have not already done so, test your home for radon. Thank you.
Great. Thank you very much, Kelly. I've launched the poll to find out how many people have indeed tested their home for radon. Just leave this up for another couple of seconds, and then I'll share the results with everybody. All right. So we see about 70% have, which I guess is not surprising, given that I imagine a lot of people tuned in today to hear this particular topic, and will likely go away and buy a test kit when they finish work today. So thank you again. I'm going to look at some of the questions now, and here is one. I'll just show it on the screen. So can you see that question, Kelly? Kelly, you're on. Oh, there you go.
Yes, yeah, I just realized. I live between nuclear plants. Will this affect the radon level of my home? No. No, that's a totally different type of radiation. So living near a nuclear plant doesn't impact the amount of radon that's potentially in your home. It's what impacts the amount of radon in your home is the amount of uranium in the ground in and around your home, and as well the way that you live in the home. I mentioned earlier, again, it's a mix of your ventilation system, how you live in the home, how much radon is drawn from the soil gas into your house.
Okay, and I've shown another question here as well. Yeah. On the range and the levels.
Yes. So great question. And this is a conversation that we recently had with our Federal Provincial Territorial Radiation Protection Committee. Because we don't set the guidelines on our own, we do that in collaboration with the provinces and the territories. At this point in time, we have not, we're not changing the guideline. The discussion continues. The reason for that is the World Health Organization's recommendation is actually to be in a range of 100 to 300, and so we fall well within that range. And we have good momentum with the program. Changing the guideline would slow some of that down. At this point in time, we don't want to do that. But the other, and I just lost my train of thought. The other consideration for us is, you know what, I'm going to have to, if you want to show me the next question, I'll come back to that because it just totally slipped my mind.
So sure.
Just having this conversation.
I'm going to show this question. You can refresh your memory on the last one. And
thank
then
you.
I'm going to hold we have several other questions, mm-hmm. but I'm going to hold those to the end to give time to Francis for his presentation, and we'll come back to these questions, okay?
Absolutely.
So please go ahead and answer this one, and then yes. We'll move along and come back to the question.
Yeah, and I'll come back to the 100, because I have remembered, but I'll come back to that at the end. No, you do not need to test any longer. Our recommendation is 3 months. If you test for 3 months, 90 plus days, that is indicative of your annual average exposure. You can test for longer.
Yeah, and you want to encourage people to test in their winter because typically the homes are more sealed, right? You're ventilating more in the summer, correct?
Correct. Unless of course you have air conditioning, and then you're just as sealed up in the summer. So if you test in the summer and your doors or windows are open, that's not necessarily, it's going to be potentially reducing the radon level and not representative of what you're breathing the large majority of the year.
Okay. Gotcha. Thank you. Okay. Now, before I introduce our final speaker, I'm going to launch our final poll for today. And this one has to do with mold in your home. So if people can vote, I'll share the results in a second. Okay, as you can see here, we've got some pretty clean homes, which is great. All right, I'm going to close this poll now and introduce our final speaker, Francis Lavoie from Health Canada. Please take it away, Francis.
Oh, hi. Hi, everyone. Thank you for staying until the end to watch or hear, listen to my presentations. My name is Francis Lavoie. I'm a biologist with the Indoor Air Contaminants Assessment Section. Just for the record, there's an Outdoor Air Assessment Section, so all those PM questions could, and I think it's been mentioned in the attendee chat, but these are the people with all the answers to the PM and busy road distance, safe distance. So feel free to contact us at the end of the presentations. There's the AIR address. It's a first for us, so I'm very happy to be presenting. It's always a pleasure to present. I hope I'm good enough so we get invited again in the future. So let's talk about mold. Why should we talk about mold? And I'm very surprised with the poll results because we do have, and IACAS stands for Indoor Air Contaminants Assessment Section. We do receive about 400 public inquiries a year, either through emails or the phone. People, believe it or not, still use the phone to ask us questions about whatever indoor air quality problems they have. 95% of the questions are on mold. Either what are the health effects of mold, how to remove it, should the air be tested for mold, my landlord doesn't want to do anything, what are my rights as a tenant. So it's pretty much, from what we understand, is the most common air pollution problem indoors. The other 5% of the questions are about off-gassing, workplace health, identify indoor air quality issues. So some people say, I'm sick, but I don't know what the problem is. And others, and you wouldn't believe how weird, how many weird questions do we get. It gets pretty weird sometimes. So what is mold? Actually, mold is the common word for fungus, which are microscopic mushrooms that we're all familiar with. So here are some pictures. Obviously, and we all encountered or experienced a moldy bread, which is the lower left, moldy oranges. In the top middle is the microscopic image of mold, so you kind of see that it's you see the fur. Top right is the petri dish, so it's a mold culture, and bottom right is what it kind of looks like when it's indoors. It's usually black mold, but as you can see with the bread, it could be green or it could be yellow or it could be any color. Why does mold grow? So the picture here is a little bit dramatic, but it's just to show that water is the key here. If you do have mold, it's because there's a water problem of some sort. So it could be a leaking pipe, an infiltration, and or a flood, obviously a flood in the basement or anywhere else in the home. An infiltration, that which includes the basement is leaking, the foundation is leaking, the roof is leaking, so infiltration from the roof, infiltration from the brick wall, the exterior wall. It could be a water damage, and by damage I mean a washing machine breaks up or the water heater explodes and leaves the let water everywhere. A dishwasher leaks, so there's water everywhere. And that, trust me, that happens pretty often. But it could also be a high humidity problem. On a day-to-day basis, on a day-to-day life, we do produce some amounts of humidity. So hopefully everyone takes a shower or a bath. We do laundry. We cook. So when you cook, obviously, when you boil water to make spaghetti or pasta, you see the steam coming out. But if you only stir fry vegetables, you see there's steam produced when you cook. Or it could just be a sewage backup. Like some cities are better than other, but sewage backup could. It's kind of related to a flood. But it's instead of being, like, so to speak, clean water from the river, it's dirty or contaminated water. So these are the major cause, and it could be other causes as well, but these are the major ones. Things that can be moldy. So what can mold grow on? So it could be on food, like we just saw with the bread and the vegetables or the oranges. Everyone had like a moldy cucumber in their fridge vegetable drawer at some point, which is pretty gross, but this is mold. Carpets, ceilings, walls, furniture, bathroom, living rooms, basements, toys, plastic toys, like it's been seen moldy. Pillows and mattresses, cushions, wood beams, drywall, books, basically anything that can be wet. So anything can get moldy if it gets wet enough. Some materials, obviously plastic toys, need to be wet more than a book, for example. A book is really easy to get wet. So basically mold can grow on pretty much everything. What are the health effects of mold? It's important to mention that most of the people, we are not sensitive to mold. We are exposed to mold on a regular basis, both indoors and outdoors. So there's always mold spores in the air, especially here, like right now in the fall, like all the leaves are getting moldy and decomposing in the sidewalks. If you walk in the forest, if you walk. So mold is pretty much everywhere and we're exposed to it on a daily basis, and most of us don't have any reaction or are not sensitive to mold. However, some people are sensitive, and for those people, even a small amount of mold can cause a reaction. So it's pretty much like if you're allergic to something, no matter how much of it you're exposed to, you'll have reactions. It could happen to anyone, so anyone can be sensitive, but obviously babies and kids, seniors and people with asthma are more sensitive to mold or any other indoor air contaminants. The symptoms are pretty much like an allergy reaction symptoms. So we're talking about eyes, nose, and throat irritation, tears, teary eyes, we sneeze a lot, allergy symptoms, difficulty breathing, and exacerbation of asthma if you're an asthmatic. So obviously some of those symptoms are very light, like sneezing and like having watery eyes is pretty light, but difficulty breathing and an asthma attack because you're asthmatic and you're sensitive to mold, that could be pretty serious. So we recommend, like, if you have any of those symptoms, you should go see a physician to make sure if it's not related to any other cause. How to prevent mold growth. So like I said, when you have mold, it's always related to a water issue or water problems. So the best way is to prevent those water problems. So repair plumbing leaks. So as soon as you see a leak from the plumbing system, we recommend repairing it as soon as you notice it. Repair an infiltration, which sounds pretty obvious, but sometimes people don't really make the connection between mold and the infiltration. So sometimes the roof is leaking and you don't really know that it's leaking, the foundation's leaking, a brick wall. Keep in mind that if the roof is leaking, usually with the gravity, the water doesn't really stay up. So like anything else. So if the roof is leaking, the problem might not be in the roof or in the attic. It could be down in the basement because the water went all the way down to the basement and accumulated in the basement. So the mold could be at different levels of, obviously if the foundation is leaking, the mold is probably going to be in the basement, but if the roof is leaking or a brick wall or window is leaking, it could be at higher levels. After a flood, we usually recommend drying everything, removing the water, obviously, and dry everything properly within 48 hours. That is in theory. In practice, it's very, sometimes people have to wait for insurance or professionals to clean it up because you have to cut the drywalls up to where the water levels went to. So if the water went 2 feet high, you need to cut at least for 2 feet. Dry everything with fans and unfortunately throw away anything that cannot be dried out. So if you have a mattress or carpets or drywall that is very wet from a flood, obviously that's not dryable. One thing that people don't really think about is the dryer exhaust. So make sure your dryer exhaust vents to the outside. So, and I'm not sure if they're still popular today, maybe in apartments. Back in the days, we used to have like those bins where when you don't have like an exhaust for your dryer vent, you would just attach it to a bin just to collect the lint and everything. But the moisture has to go somewhere, and it obviously doesn't stay in that little bin. It goes in the bathroom or in the laundry room. Make sure it's not, and if it vents to the outside, make sure it's not blocked by lint or snow or debris. And on top, and I want to focus on this, keep humidity levels low by either using an exhaust fan in the kitchen when you cook, or even if you don't boil water, just the fact of cooking or stir frying vegetables create moisture. And obviously use your bathroom fan when you take a shower. sometimes it's not efficient enough or it's not sufficient depending on how much moisture you produce on a day-to-day basis. So we recommend using a dehumidifier. The humidity level recommended is between 30 and 50%. And obviously it's not as, nothing is black and white. So it's not like, oh yeah, 41% mold's growing. Of course not. And you would have a peak. We all do have peaks of humidity. Depending on the time of the day, like usually in the morning it's higher, or at night it's higher. But it might reach 65% for 20 minutes, which is kind of fine if it goes back to 40. But if it's on a regular basis, 60, 65, 70%, it's way too high and it could lead to mold growth. What if you did all this and you still, or you didn't do all this and it's too late? You do have mold in your home. So what to do and how do you deal with it? So Health Canada, we recommend cleaning up small or medium-sized patches of mold. And how to do so is you just use soap and water, actually. So either dish soap or a spray soap for smooth, hard surfaces. So that includes all those plasticky toys that I talked about. It includes the ceramic tiles around the bathtub. It includes the painted wall, which is pretty smooth. So just spray soap, just spray or whatever spray soap, or use a dish soap and water, a cloth, or you can use a brush to make it more efficient. And usually it cleans up, it's pretty easily cleanable. If not cleanable, you need to throw those things away. And by not cleanable, example of non-cleanable things include, like I said earlier, mattresses, pillows, drywall. Obviously it's not cleanable if it gets moldy. Cushion, books, carpets, everything that you cannot really dry or clean properly. Obviously, a pillow, you can throw it in the washing machine, but it's kind of like hard to dry afterwards. We recommend hiring a professional in the case of a large mold problem. So small and medium, you can do it yourself. Bigger than 1 meter by 1 meter, we recommend using hiring a professional to do so, because it's probably bigger than you think, and it's easily overwhelming for people to replace the materials. Replace moldy building materials, like I said, if you have a flood in your basement, or if you have been if you had a roof leaking for a while, everything's moldy. You cannot clean the beams. You cannot clean the 2x4s if they're moldy. You need to replace those materials. So open up the walls, change everything. I know it's a major renovation. It could be a major renovation. It could be as easy as just cutting a piece of drywall, changing it, and like change the insulation, like the mineral wool, for example, in the walls. But it could be like an entire room, and that is bigger renovations, but it's worth doing it properly so mold doesn't come back afterwards. And that brings me to the next bullet, which is fix the underlying water or moisture problem. Like I said, mold is always associated with water. And if you no matter how much you clean it, if you change all the drywall, if you change the beams, the materials, you do a brand new living room or a brand new TV room in the basement, if you don't fix the water problem, or if you don't fix the roof leaking, the water's still there and mold is going to come back. We don't recommend testing for mold, and that's my last bullet. We don't recommend testing for mold because it doesn't really provide you any information on health, and it does not address the cause. Most of the time, people, they do see mold, and their first reflex is to test for it, and it's not going to bring you any information. It's going to tell you, well, you've got mold, and you know that. And in big red, I just mentioned no bleach, because people tend to want to use bleach. But it's not necessary. A spray soap or dish soap works fine. But not only it's not necessary, but it's very, you can burn your eyes, you can burn your skin, it's very irritant. And the vapors, the bleach vapors, can irritate your throat or your bronchi. So we don't really recommend using it. And it's not more efficient than a dish soap. Resources, we do pretty much like Kelly. We do have like a bunch of outreach materials. So we have fact sheets on how to address moisture and mold in your home, what to do if you have a flood and how to clean it up. We have a visual fact sheet. We have indoor air quality houses, checklists. So everything could be available upon request. And the last slide is actually our website, which also has been moved to canada.ca, but the URL healthcanada.gc.ca/air still works. And air@hc-sc.gc.ca is our generic email address, both for any questions, if you want to get like publications, or if you have more follow-up questions, or if you find out that you have mold, like those 70% of people who didn't think they have it, and then suddenly they find it out. If you don't know what to do with it, just give us drop us an email.
Great. Well, thank you very much, Francis. As I mentioned, we are going to take questions now both for the radon presentation and for the mold presentation. So I've displayed here the question, one of the questions about radon, and if Kelly, you could come back and address that, please.
Sure. So no, radon cannot be absorbed into any items. It's the type of radon that it is. Alpha radiation, it can be stopped by our skin, by anything that's protecting the food. So it can't penetrate those things. That's why the only known risk is lung cancer, because when we breathe the radon into our lungs, it can attach to our unprotected, very open lung tissue. So the answer is no. That's it. Do you have an estimate of the proportion of homes? Yes. Based on our Cross Canada survey, we've done two large-scale surveys, and we estimate about 7% of homes have high levels, so quite a significant amount. But that really varies across the country. There are parts of the country where it's 20 to 30 to 40% of homes. Ventilation can help. Not so much necessarily the fan. The testing that we've done with regards to ventilation as a radon reduction method would be more air exchanger or heat recovery ventilator that Stephanie spoke about at the beginning of the presentation. And based on the research that's been done, that type of ventilation can reduce the radon level by up to 50%. So it depends on how much you have to begin with, whether or not this is a good solution. If you already have it or you're planning to install that type of ventilation system, then it can help. But installing a new ventilation system is actually more expensive typically than installing a radon reduction system.
Okay, we're going to go back and forth a little bit. This question is related to mold.
Oh, yeah.
So, Francis, if you can take it away.
There are natural products that people can use more days, and I'm assuming that any natural spray soap would work. A lot of people, they mentioned using vinegar and water. It's very popular these days, baking soda and vinegar. So it's absolutely like it is effective to clean up mold. Yeah. That is actually a very good question. How you can measure up the moisture level in your home? It's actually very easy. You can buy yourself a hygrometer. Hygrometer, yeah. It's like a thermometer, but it measures up humidity. So it's a passive thing that you can buy at any hardware store. It's about like, I don't think it's even like $10. It's a passive thing that you put on a table or in a bookshelf or in a dresser, and it tells you what percentage of humidity it is in your home. And what's very nice with those things is that pretty much like a thermometer, you can bring it from one room to another. So you can see how it is in the basement or how it is in the living room or the bedrooms and it usually tells you a percentage. So that's also very handy.
Great, thank you. So I think this will be our last question, and it's related to lobbying and rebate programs for radon, Kelly.
How is lobbying going to get rebate programs for radon mitigation? It would certainly help folks test. Yes. So I'm not sure I completely understand the question, but Health Canada certainly is encouraging provinces and territories to consider different options for supporting or making radon mitigation in particular more accessible, because testing really is accessible. It's not expensive, and it's not something actually I mentioned earlier, but to do it yourself, you're looking at, you know, $20 to $40. You hire a professional, you're going to pay a little bit more for the service that you're getting. There are already some programs available in different parts of the country. So for example, in Ontario, actually, if you have a new home and it's covered under the Tarion home warranty, the seven-year warranty, radon mitigation is covered. So you just need to test and find out if you have high levels, and your mitigation system, if you do have high levels, would be covered under your warranty. In Manitoba Hydro actually has a funding program, financing program for radon mitigation. We would love to see more of those. There has been a recommendation by the Green Budget Coalition for the last couple of years for an income tax rebate for radon mitigation that would go at the federal level. We've encouraged this to be considered. It hasn't yet been approved. And so I've lost the question, but I think that's pretty much the answer. And just one other thing, just to finish that answer with regards to the lowering of the guideline, as we continue the discussions with our federal provincial partners, one of the things we have done is we have changed our messaging, because we did realize that people were misinterpreting the guideline level as anything under 200 is safe, and that's absolutely not the case. So in a lot of our outreach materials now, we have the message, and I quote, "While the health risk from radon exposure below the Canadian guideline is smaller, there is no level that is considered risk-free. It's the choice of each homeowner to decide what level of radon exposure they're willing to accept."
All right. Well, thank you very much. That concludes our webinar today. After this ends, you will see on your screen a link to our survey, and we'd appreciate it if you could just take a moment to complete that, help us plan our webinars in the future. And I want to take a moment to thank very much Kelly Bush and Francis Lavoie for their input today on as our health experts. And thanks to all our participants for staying through the webinar and asking great questions. So until next time, thanks very much, and goodbye for today.
Thank you.
Thank you.